Kate, rural Arkansas is a considerably different world than Shrewsbury, Massachusetts. Different culture, different people, different political and economic structures. Mm-hmm. What's it been like for you to make that big transition?
I think I'm surprised in how easy it's been. I don't know, I just really connect with a lot of the people in this area. I found a lot of like-minded people, and I really have enjoyed it. I think that maybe I associate or connect easier with people on the Eureka side of the river, but I just love it here, and everyone is so kind and welcoming, and my gosh, we have the world's best neighbors. All of our neighbors buy our food. We have Gary Shelton across the street, and then the Hayes family, Aaron Hayes, next door, and some new people that moved in, whose name is Dirk Rhodes, which sounds like Dirt Rhodes. That's how we remember him. And anyway, just amazing people, and they all are so supportive of our little farm and what we're doing, and it's just
great.
I don't know, I couldn't imagine a better place to live, honestly. I love it here.
All right. Drew, is the long range plan is to make a living.
That would be a good start for sure.
What advice would you give for a young couple like you and Kate if they were thinking about starting up a small sustainable farming business?
Well, we're still trying to figure it out ourselves, but like for instance, we went a few weeks ago to this Farm Foundations workshop for the weekend, and it was put on by ATRA and a couple other organizations, and get in touch with your local office and look into some of these programs that ATRA extension office and because they have some really good programs about how to manage your finances and how to how to make it work and make it pay and make it into a real living. And I think the biggest thing I would say is, don't sit around and dream about it. Just do it. You have to start to get anywhere. And especially with small scale poultry production, it's not expensive. And all the infrastructure is really cheap. It's not like buying a $250,000 Tyson's chicken house. It's for probably $5,000 or something, you could set up your set up a brooder and a bunch of pasture pens and buy all your waters and everything you need and order chickens.
What's interesting, several years ago I did a project with the Rural America Foundation where I did cash flow analysis of almost 300 poultry operations, and most of them were these sort of industrial production facilities. And what I discovered then is that in terms of the bottom line, small-scale producers like yourselves had almost as much net profit as the big operators did.
With almost no overhead.
The difference, of course, is that when the big operators get ready to die, they've got a bunch of physical assets to
pass on. They've got a bunch of debt to pass on to their children.
But they do have a lot of equity. No, that's a good point. We're not growing as much equity here.
Yeah, but in terms of livelihood, in terms of making a living, the small scale, sustainable, organic operators and pasture operators like yourselves really make about as much money at the end of the year is these folks with the big, big, long row house industrial operations.
Yeah. Well, there's definitely a scale at which that happens, and we're not quite there yet. But I think the scale is approximately, you know, doing something like maybe 7,000 to 10,000 birds a year. There's a farm in Marshall, Arkansas called Falling Sky Farm, and I think they're at about that level with their pasture poultry operation, and they're at about the point where they will be making about as much, or if not more, than, you know, the industrial operations. They're currently putting almost all their money back into the farm to build more equity. But yes, I mean, that's where we are. We're going to process about 1,200 birds this year. And it's small enough that money definitely needs to go directly back into the farm in order to grow it, because it's simply not enough for any kind of living, really. But our margin per bird of what we're able to make is enough to sustain the operation and to grow the farm.
Yeah, I mean, you just look at the basic numbers, you know, like a Tyson's Chicken House, you know, they may have 10 or 20 or 30,000 birds, or, you know, whatever it is in there, but they're generally getting paid about 20 cents per bird.
Right.
And they don't have to pay any of the input costs, because the input costs are handled by Tyson's as well. But for us, we have to pay the input costs, and we have to buy the chicks, and we have to, you know.
Mm-hmm. Which is a cash flow problem, nothing else, at the beginning.
Yeah, so. At the beginning, it's in the spring, it's kind of hard to get going unless you have some money set aside. But where I was going with that is, you know, at the end, they get about 20 cents a bird, you know, whereas we get, you know, $12 to $15 a bird. So that's a pretty huge, you know, swing in price, and they're really... I think they're losing out on a lot of money that, you know, they're giving it away to Tyson's or to, you know, whoever the company is that they work for.
Of course, we should make clear we don't keep $12 a bird.
No.
that's you know, including, that's what we get for the bird completely, minus their input cost, which is more than half of, you know, the cost
just
of the bird.
Well, it's about half probably.
Somewhere.
Well, I had one of the very first chickens that you guys raised, and I have to say it was an astonishingly good bird.
Yeah, the Freedom Rangers, I think, just because they were older, had a little bit more depth of taste than these birds. But these birds taste really good, and they cook more like what you would get in the grocery store. So you can just go ahead and fry up the, you know, the legs and thighs, and it's gonna work perfectly. Whereas, you know, on our other birds, you had to braise the legs and thighs, and then it was beautiful. But otherwise, it didn't work the same. So,
well, Kate, where can the folks buy one of your chickens?
Right now, they can buy it in three ways. You can buy it at the Eureka Springs Farmers Market on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7 to noon. Actually, we're only there on Thursdays, so on Thursday from 7 to noon. Our birds are also found at the Eureka Market, which is a small grocery store on East Van Buren, the natural food store in Eureka. And then they can always get it on farm on our processing days. Our next processing day happens to be about July 6th.
July 6th?
Yeah, and that's a way to get fresh birds. So if anyone wanted a fresh whole chicken, they would just contact us at Shade Grove.
All right. Well, we've been talking with Drew Wood and Kate Ombach at Shady Grove Farm. Drew and Katie, thank you so much for being our guests on the Ozark Harvest Radio Hour.
Thank you.
Many, many thanks to Kate Ombach and Drew Wood of Shady Grove Farms for sharing their story with us. I find young people like Drew and Katie to be very, very inspiring, and I am grateful that I've gotten to know them. If you get a chance, drive out to Shady Grove Farm and meet them. They're south on 327 and at the junction where 327 meets County Road 322. The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is a production of Carroll County Fresh. We thank writer and producer Dan Croats, Dr. Sharon Sloan, who is our technology director. We thank Dr. Fred Mayer, music director, Richard Pillay, reporter and editorialist, Mary Hyatt, national spokesperson for Living Better Without Chemistry. And we thank the board of directors of Carroll County Fresh, Jane Pillay, president, Andrew Schwerin, vice president, John Toombs, treasurer, and the Reverend Judy Turner of Christview Ministries, secretary. We also thank St. Fiacre, patron saint of gardeners, and the program theologian. And to our listeners, the Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is organic radio, not always perfect, not always pretty, but always fresh, local, and honest.
One, two, three, four.